Hello, I'm John Hart Asher from Lady Bird Johnson Wildflower Center, stepping in for Tom Spencer. Today, we've got a really exciting topic. We've got Vincent Debrock here with us, who is a certified arborist, also an owner at the Heritage Tree Care. But today, he's serving in the capacity you're a board member of TreeFolks.
Hi, John.
It's great to have you here. So we're going to do a sort of quick dive into trees, all things trees that we can talk about really quickly. So I wanted to start with this sort of larger discussion about climate change in trees. How do trees really make a difference with climate change?
Well, trees just simply the biggest plant in the landscaping, so the biggest effects, that's
fair
where
enough.
It starts. And I call them kind of the Swiss Army knife of our tool set when we're dealing with green infrastructure. So trees act very much as carbon sequestration tools. So of course, the more trees you have, the more carbon sequestration you have. So it makes it just a lot of sense to use that as a real tool for really climate change and control.
And they do a lot of other things with controlling the immediate climate, like heat island mitigation and that sort of thing. But they also serve as really particularly in a role of introducing habitat in cities, but they also do a lot of things in terms of human health and well-being, right? They help out psychologically and physiologically with us as well.
Right, we're starting to see a lot of research coming out. Really in the last 15 years, it's been exploding where we are realizing that the psychological effect or really the physiological effects of really hanging out with trees, simply said, has a lot of health benefits. So we're looking at campuses with more greenery provide really better results with students. The healing effects are quicker. The really making you happy makes you healing faster. And apparently just doing that forest walk will really help you with that. It just softens up everything around you. It's a lot better to have really the greenery and the shade coming from a live plant than having to deal with just plain concrete in your city. It's
sure.
Just simply intuitive.
And then some of the trees as well, they're not only just the shade is cooling the area, but the way they are actually interacting with the air, they're creating evaporation that actually cools the ambient temperature, correct?
There's really an AC effect. It's not just being in the shade.
Right.
You can go in the shade under an artificial canopy and just step onto under a tree canopy, and you'll really feel that temperature difference. And that's been shown a long time ago. You just look at the infrared pictures in cityscapes where you have trees and where you have just shade from buildings, and the difference is tremendous. Plus that effect, that evapotranspiration that you have, their whole effect of sucking the energy out of the air cools the air.
Mm-hmm.
Instead of having a heat sink with inert materials like concrete and rock and so on. So
right.
Great difference.
That's wonderful. And let's talk about celebrating trees. Texas Arbor Day.
Right, well, this is the exciting time of the year. You know, a few years back, the legislator was smart to change the Arbor Day celebration from April to November.
Ah, why?
So every year, in the first Friday of November, is our Texas Arbor Day. The reason that we did this, that this was done, is simply that we have now three seasons to establish the tree plantings.
Mm-hmm.
So when we plant trees, it's a fairly big plant. It takes time to establish, and as we all know, our Texas summers are a little bit rough. So what we're trying to provide by planting in the fall is fall, winter, and spring for root establishment.
Mm.
If you plant in April, like on the northern states, the more traditional Arbor Day, then the tree goes right from a planting set to 2 months after having to deal with extreme temperatures. And 90 degrees and above, a tree will not establish itself. It will just survive, and we'll just be watering it to keep it alive. So we're really wasting a lot of water and time to try to establish trees when we plant very late in the year. So preferably November mm-hmm. and up to winter time, great planting season.
So that would be winter time because let's talk about, sometimes I call winter warmer here because we
right.
don't really drop. So when would you say the extent of that day would be, you know, November to when?
Well, commercially we'll plant all year long, but ideally what you want to do is try to plant maybe up to March.
Okay.
And then we still have the whole, if you have to wait to March to plant, you still have a couple of months of real root establishment,
right.
which is really precious for any plant to deal with. Really what you like to understand is, as you're planting in the fall, winter is not really dormant around here. We still have a lot of growth happening mm-hmm. in the soil. The soil does not freeze.
Right.
So that's why it's really important to take advantage of it. It's so hard to establish a big plant.
Sure.
So we got to give it every opportunity we have to make it happen and really not waste our time and energy.
That's great. Well, you know, let's sort of segue a little bit to talk about, I know there's been a lot of viewers who are concerned about impacts to their trees because of the sort of micro drought that we're in right now. What are, you know, some of those effects that we might see or maybe not see till a little bit later down in the season?
That's funny that you bring that up. That's one of the most common questions we have right now in my practice, where we just get these regular calls. Is my tree sick, or do I have oak wilt? The leaves are dropping and it's not fall yet. It's still summertime. And really, some trees react to heat. Cottonwoods are a famous example where as soon as the drought comes up, they will drop foliage to prevent losing moisture. But also, when we have the type of a summer that we have had with more than 50 days of 100 degree weather, the soil dries up very deeply beyond the wilting point of the soil.
Right.
So then we have roots cracking and we have trees really impacted by this. So it will take a while for trees to recover when they have been damaged so deeply. So when you see a tree that shows serious, significant leaf drop, or really the leaves are scorching and turning yellow, burning up, even some of our local cedar elm trees right now are doing that. Yeah, I just saw it on the way here. You look at the Disc Golf Course and Zilker Park, and look at the cedar elm trees. Their canopies have lost pretty much 50% of the foliage. And the rest does not look very green anymore. So those are the ones that are in trouble. Those are the ones where we want to protect and really help with the root system. That soil is probably too exposed, too dried up, needs more organic matter, more mulching. That's where we can help and really trying to compensate over the next couple of years.
Okay, and so, you know, again, you mentioned mulching. Are there any other strategies that we would want to consider to sort of help out a tree in that sort of drought state, maybe perhaps like deeper watering? Or
right.
I think maybe a lot of people, they see stuff going brown, they think, oh, I need to fertilize a lot right now.
Right. I would tend to be careful with the fertilizer. Plus, if the soil is very cracked and dry, the fertilizer is not going to do much. What we need is live soil. So the best thing is to make sure you have healthy, non-compacted soil. That's the biggest problem in urban environment,
right,
is compacted soil for trees. That's the biggest tree killer, and it's hard to know that you have compacted soil. So that's the first thing, look at your soil. Second is, we gotta have compost. We have to have soil life, and that's compost and mulch. So the compost will start introducing organic matter again, then you top it off with mulch, that way you kind of shortcut that direct sunlight on the soil and
right,
start controlling temperature and moisture. And eventually then, if you're in growing season, especially fall and spring, you can think about fertilizing. I would recommend, of course, going with organic fertilizers.
Mm-hmm.
They have a whole lot less salt, so we don't have salt buildup in our urban soils. That's a big thing also. A one-time regular fertilizer or traditional fertilizer treatment is not harmful, but repeatedly, we tend to see mineral buildup instead.
Okay.
So organic also would be the best way to go.
Okay.
So compost, mulch, watering, and the deep watering is obvious. It's a lot of water for trees.
Right. Well, that's very succinct and wonderful advice. And so this sort of, to step back again, this larger challenge of climate change and really how people can make a difference, what are the best ways that people can really get involved with sort of dealing with climate change or volunteering?
Oh, there's quite a few ways. Well, you can start at home. You know, you can plant trees wherever you have space. You call an arborist if you're not sure how to do it, or a landscaper, and figure out which tree and what location. You want to make sure you've got the right tree at the right place.
Sure.
It's kind of a mantra for arborists, is not all trees belong everywhere. You just have to figure out which one. And I would highly recommend visiting the TreeFolks website, treefolks.org, because you can really step up and volunteer with our tree plantings. And you can also get the free trees at our neighborhood events, where we just give and donate all the trees through the neighborhoods program that the city of Austin sponsors. So we have quite a bit of opportunities there.
And there's also then, you know, we've had some pretty catastrophic events like the Blanco River flood in 2015, where I know TreeFolks really served as a leader in doing some large-scale tree planting as well.
Right, and I think this is where nonprofits like TreeFolks really benefit the community. They're able to step in and adapt to situations that are very serious and mobilize very quickly and really focus the energies towards mm-hmm. a rehealing process. Mm-hmm. Not only healing the ecology, but really this was a community effort and community rebuilding. That's what TreeFolks really is really great at. The fact that we have that experience build up in planting trees and managing mm-hmm. those community projects and quickly adapting to whatever can happen. The Bastrop reforestation was another big big event that TreeFolks was able to step in with.
Right.
So think about those nonprofits that you have locally and just get involved with them. That helps a lot.
There's lots of opportunity. And then, important event here. I have to say happy birthday because it's, 30 years of TreeFolks, correct?
30 years at TreeFolks. And you opened up the conversation with really the climate change. And that was the impetus back in 30 years ago.
Wow.
The founders of TreeFolks were thinking we need to fight climate change, and what better way than to plant trees? Here we are 30 years later, and we have planted at least 2.8 million trees through our history, through multiple projects, and we have done a lot of educative programs, a lot of community outreach, and things are exciting, times are exciting.
Well, that's some really, really good work, and really quickly, there are plenty of places where you can check in, and they actually offer trees. The City of Austin, if you're a customer, I know, and then TreeFolks as well. Certain events offers free trees from time to time.
Right. Go on the website. They'll have a list of all the events where you donate the trees. They also have all the opportunities to go and help out and volunteer in community tree plantings in public spaces, and all the information is out there. TreeFolks.org.
Thank you so much for coming and visiting with us today, Vincent. And it sounds really wonderful that the trees can do so much for us if we just take a little time and dig a hole.
Thank you, John.
All righty. Well, let's check in now with Daphne.